Portsmouth Point, or Spice Island, is part of Old Portsmouth. It was here that the men were press-ganged into Nelson's Navy. The area forms the eastern side of the narrow entrance to Portsmouth Harbour, facing Gosport on the western side. Today it's a busy harbour with an array of merchant ships, ferries, and of course the Royal Navy. The Spinnaker Tower is a 560-foot landmark and was the centrepiece of the redevelopment of Portsmouth Harbour. A recent sponsorship deal with Emirates Airline saw the tower renamed Emirates Spinnaker Tower in July 2015. A short walk from the tower takes us to the Portsmouth Guildhall. The building was completed in 1890 and was designed in the neoclassical style by architect William Hill. The building celebrates its 125th anniversary and is a popular place to come and take lunch or just look at the domineering lions, of course not forgetting Queen Victoria, which, by the way, one of the five bells in the clock tower are named after her. Take a short walk around the back of the Guildhall and we walk into Victoria Park. It was officially opened on the 25th of May, 1878, and was one of the first public parks to be opened in the city. It has a total area of around 15 acres and again, like the Guildhall, is a popular place to relax on a summer's afternoon. We find ourselves back down in Old Portsmouth and for a very good reason. Just off the High Street we come across the Royal Garrison Church, which dates back to 1212. It's the oldest garrison church in the world and has been called the British Military Cathedral. The garrison chancel remains, but the nave is roofless and is a popular tourist attraction. Portsmouth Cathedral is the next port of call, with its splendid bell tower, looking down onto the High Street, which it's been doing since 1180. The Bishop of Portsmouth resides here, and the cathedral is the Church of England Diocese of Portsmouth. Just through the trees, we can see the outlines of another magnificent church, the Cathedral Church of St. John the Evangelist, also known as St. John's Cathedral. It was opened in 1882, and it's the first cathedral to be built in Portsmouth. The new church was opened for worship and was immediately made the mother church of the new Catholic Diocese of Portsmouth. The old chapel was closed, and the cathedral was completed in four phases. There is one particular church that a lot of people of Portsmouth can associate and is located in a busy part of the city. And we've arrived to take a look around this incredible Portsmouth landmark. With the oldest recorded church site in Portsmouth, it's worth taking some time to look closely at St. Mary's Church. Its history stretches back to the 11th century. The church has been described as the finest Victorian building in Hampshire, and within the grounds and the church, there are many memorials that can be seen when you take a walk around this Grade II listed building. At the west end of the church, you'll come across the 180-foot tower. And as you travel around the city, you can't help noticing the former highest landmark in Portsmouth. Just to the right of the main entrance is the stone, and records that on behalf of Queen Victoria, the Crown Princess of Germany, Princess Royal of Great Britain and Ireland, opened the church. Once you step through the main entrance, you're presented with this vast space and splendid architecture. Christians have been worshipping here for over 1500 years. The church was consecrated on the 10th of October, 1889, and is part of the parish of St Mary's, Portsea, which also includes nearby churches of St Wilfrid's and St Faith's. St Mary's was designed by Sir Arthur Bloomfield and was intended to look like the chief parish church of a great town. The ornate marble font is also worth taking a closer look at too. The church was built with the support from the then First Sea Lord, W.H. Smith, and well over half the cost was met by him. It was a build to be an inspiration to its people. Many events are held at the church, and today we see the nearly new sale, as well as an open day. It's a chance for the public to pop in and see the delights St Mary's has to offer. We caught up with one of the volunteers and asked her, what is there on offer at today's event? As a volunteer, you've attended many of the church events. So how long have you had an association with St Mary's? Everyone has plenty of things to be doing, but there's always time for a well-made cup of tea.
Thank you.
A St Mary's church was built in the 12th century. The building served the parish until 1843, and throughout its history, the church played an important role in the life of the island, especially Fratton, Lamport and Buckland. At the west end was the square tower, and inside was the gallery, with uncomfortable high box pews, with flaps for the poor on their doors. In 1843, the second St Mary's was erected to serve the rapidly growing parish. It was built at a cost of £5,000. 1889 saw the build of this imposing St Mary's Church that we have here today. The current vicar has been at St Mary's for some 15 years, working alongside his colleagues within the parish. How does a typical day start for a vicar in this open-door church? The ever-popular Mayfair celebrated its 30th year in 2015. But how did it all start back in 1986? At St Mary's Church, and once in a while, members of the public have the opportunity to take a climb up its 180-foot tower. It was the highest landmark in Portsmouth until the Spinnaker Tower was built in 2005. A project to raise £900,000 was launched to restore the historical tower, and a £300,000 grant from English Heritage and the Lottery Fund was given towards the project. There are 207 steps, spanning five levels, But once you reach the top, there are some spectacular views to be seen, looking over every part of the city. The first level is the ringing chamber, and this is where the bell ringers ring peals. It's an interesting place to take time from your climb and take a close look at the many wall shields and plaques that adhere to the walls. Now you've had your rest, there's more climbing to be done. During your climb, there are the church volunteers who keep an eye on things throughout your visit. They're also here to answer the many questions that visitors might ask. The next level into the clock chamber will give you a glimpse of the Gillett and Johnson clock. The bell chamber contains 8 bells, some dating back from the 18th century, and they were recast in 1933. You may have noticed that your climb includes narrow wooden steps, but it's all quite safe, I can assure you. Making your way up even higher and heading for the 4th level, the volunteers keep an eye on the visitor movements and operate a system where they hold visitors on one level and allow other visitors to come down from the top before you proceed with your climb. Once reaching the 4th level, it's that time again to take in the views. And from this level you get the sense of size. At the same time, take a look down to a great view of the 8 bells hanging below. You also get the view of your last part of the climb and to the outside world emerging at the top of the tower. With not too far to go now, a volunteer will carefully guide you into the open air. So brace yourself for those breathtaking views that you climbed 207 steps to reach. Over time, a great many visitors have taken the opportunity to visit the tower, as we've seen, but not many have experienced the bell ringing practice from the Portsmouth District Ringers. So another climb to the ringing chamber to see one of their practice sessions was a chance not to be missed. The massive bells were about to be rung over the city once more. But who are the ringers? What do they do, and is it an easy skill to learn? It looks complicated. So how long does it take to learn? Could anyone ring a bell at a practice session and say they're now a bell ringer? If a person is interested in learning to become a bell ringer, can they pop along to a practice and start to learn this interesting skill? Throughout the practice time, the ringing master, Lizzie Howe, keeps a close eye on the proceedings. Her experience and understanding of how everything should work and sound can be a busy role, ensuring the practice is all going smoothly. It looks exhausting to pull these large bells. It looks exhausting to pull these large bells, so is it? The organ of St Mary's is an integral part of Canon Edgar's grand vision. It was in 1888 plans for an organ to match the scope and scale were drawn up. It was completed in October 1893, and the church architect, R.A. Bloomfield, had designed an organ case, but this was not installed for another 9 years. This wonderful organ is heard at St Mary's as the choir gather for their practice. The church has had a choir for many years, but it's not just adults we see here today. A music foundation is run at St Mary's. Can you tell us a little about that and how it works?
Thank you.